So welcome. Welcome to Rare Disease Day 2017. Let's get a round of applause. My name is Katie Brandt. I am the Community Resource Specialist in the MGH Frontal Temporal Disorders Unit, and I'm the Massachusetts Ambassador for Rare Disease Day. I'm proud to welcome you all to our Rare Disease Day celebration presented by the Massachusetts Biotech Council, the MGH Center for Rare Neurologic Diseases, and the MGH Frontal Temporal Disorders Unit. So, how many people have a paddle on their seat? Wave your paddles. Oh my gosh, that looks so great from my vantage point. That looks great. So at the end of our morning's presentation, we will use these paddles to take an amazing group photo. Our photographer will be up in the balcony, so hold on to your paddle. We are joining a global movement today that spans almost 100 countries around the globe. Rare Disease Day is celebrated each year on the last day in February. The theme for this year's International Rare Disease Day is research. Rare Disease Day is coordinated in the United States by the National Organization for Rare Disorders, also known as NORD. And we're lucky to have a NORD representative, Tim Boyd, here with us today. He'll speak a little bit later this morning about NORD's legislative efforts in support of the day. Here in Boston, we know that research takes a collaborative effort. And since 2009, the Massachusetts Biotech Council and its member companies have led the charge in gathering patients, families, industry experts, researchers, medical professionals, elected officials, media, and community members together to celebrate this International Day of Recognition for the estimated 350 million people living around the world with rare disease. I would like to thank Bob Coughlin, President and CEO of MassBio, for his leadership and support of this event, and also Sarah McDonald and Susan Martin for their passion and attention to detail at every stage of our planning process. We have 14 sponsor agencies that were integral to the success of this morning's presentation. Agerion, Agios, Biogen, Chiltern, Cydan, Fulcrum Therapeutics, Karyopharm, sorry for the mispronunciation, Prometrica, Pfizer, Sanofi Genzyme, Shire, Stratacuity, Voyager, and Wave. Can we get a round of applause for our amazing sponsors? I like the acoustics in this room for the applause. That sounds good. You will also notice, and it's great, they're covered up by the many attendees here today, but there are resource tables lining the back wall with local and national resources for families living with rare diseases. Because one of the most important ways that we can support individuals living with rare disease is by connecting them with one another. And those connections don't have to remain in our city limits. Social media creates unlimited opportunities for connections. You can use the hashtags patient-driven and Rare Disease Day to tweet, post, and learn about our event and others happening worldwide. So we're at the State House this morning, and we're lucky to have so many elected officials with us today. Representative Jen Benson, Representative Michael Day, Representative Kimberly Ferguson, Representative William Galvin, Representative Solomon Goldstein-Rose, Representative Hannah Kane, Representative Natalie Higgins, and Representative Joe McKenna. Yes, round of applause. We we love having elected officials attend our event. And if I have missed any of you, please know that we're so thankful that you've taken time out of your day to come and hear about rare disease. So, most importantly, I want to thank the patients and families who are here. You are only a handful of the estimated 30 million Americans living with one of the 7,000 identified rare diseases. And Boston is showing its love for recognition of our Rare Disease Day event. At sunset tonight, look out for the Zakim Bridge to be lit up with the Rare Disease Day colors of magenta, blue, and green. And how many of you, by a show of hands, have noticed a zebra-wrapped MBTA train? That's right. So that was a fantastic marketing effort by Cambridge Biomarketing. Both are signals from our city that there's support for the rare disease community. It's an echo of NORD's message, alone we are rare, together we are strong. The spirit of community and collaboration are central to this year's Rare Disease Day slogan. With research, possibilities are limitless. My hope that this slogan speaks to the future of rare disease treatments and cures is inspired by patient voices, caregiver dedication, and even by loving someone rare, myself. But my belief in this slogan actually comes from a different place. It comes from working with my boss, the director of the MGH Frontotemporal Disorders Unit, Dr. Brad Dickerson. Dr. Dickerson and I met in 2011. We didn't meet at a conference or even during the hiring process for my position. We met at a medical appointment. At that time, I was caring for my husband, Mike, who was living with the rare disorder, frontal temporal degeneration, also known as FTD. Dr. Dickerson provided us with the highest quality of compassionate care throughout Mike's journey with FTD. He treated us with respect as partners in care decisions. In many ways, this was a revelation for me. Other physicians were not even able to diagnose my husband, let alone offer me opportunities to act as a partner, as an equal in care planning, and really to feel like there were treatment and care options for my husband. Mike passed away in 2012, and I needed a place to raise my voice against FTD. And so, our partnership continued, and Dr. Dickerson gave me a platform. I became an advocate, educator, and fundraiser in the FTD community. Since 2012, I have worked with many families traveling the journey of FTD to connect them with resources and talk with them about the importance of research participation. I know this is where progress will be made. The collaboration between families, funders, and brilliant scientists will be the winning trifecta for change. Yes, this is about collaboration, but in a lot of ways, this is about power. One of the things that rare disease wants is it wants us to think that we're powerless. Rare disease is often difficult to identify, a covert enemy poised and ready to attack. But we don't have to be passive victims. This morning's presentation is all about action. You'll hear from people who are making a difference for our rare disease community in many different ways. But you're going to hear common themes. Themes of partnership, collaboration, because there's only one way to turn powerless into power, and that's going to be by working together. So, in the spirit of working together, I'm so happy to introduce Representative Jennifer Benson. Representative Jennifer Benson was first elected to represent the Massachusetts 37th Middlesex District in 2008. She served as chair and vice chair of the Lunenburg Democratic Town Committee, where she re-energized community activists and helped to elect strong leaders to represent her region. Today, she is the chair of the Committee on Consumer Protection and Professional Licensure and co-chair of the After School and Out of School Time Coordinating Council. She is the Massachusetts Director for Women in Government. Representative Benson.
Wow, great turnout. Good morning. Good morning. All right, you're listening. Good. Well, I'm really, really thrilled to be here. And it's not because we're talking about disease, we're talking about solutions. And being together, having these conversations, and bringing light and energy to these issues are critically important in order to find those solutions. So I'm really, really happy to be here. As someone whose family has been touched by rare diseases, Huntington's and ALS currently in my family, I understand how difficult it can be for families and caregivers and entire communities to support those suffering with these diseases. So I'm really thrilled to see all of you here. So thank you, MassBio, MGH Center for Neurological Diseases, and the MGH Frontotemporal Disorders Unit for bringing us all together. Thanks to all of you for coming. So I have to say that, you know, I talk about healthcare a lot. And one of the reasons I do is I think as policymakers, it's one of the most personal issues we ever discuss and legislate. It impacts every family, every community, every sector of our economy. And so when we're here talking about healthcare issues, we're talking about a cohesive, complicated, and vitally important issue for Massachusetts. One of the reasons I know how personal it is not only am I sometimes a patient and a parent, but I also understand how policies impact patients and their families and caregivers, and which is why I decided to file a bill related to the fail first or step therapy policies that are currently very common in health plans. Because that relationship and that personal relationship between a physician and his or her patient is most important. That physician is the person who knows that patient best. And we have to make sure that their recommendations are the primary objective of all insurance coverage and treatment options. And so patient-driven is what we're here to talk about. So simply, I want to say thank you for coming. Welcome to the State House, your house. Thank you to all of my colleagues who have come. There are many who have come in since the beginning of the program, and there will be many more coming in throughout the hour. Please talk to them. Talk to them about why this is an important issue. You'll hear more about my bill, I know, later. And I thank you all for your advocacy, for your support, and your work in this area. Thank you. See, they tell me to do things and I forget everything. My staff will tell you that all the time. So I will say, it's really bad. So we can say that officially, and I won't read the entire thing, but officially the governor has proclaimed this day Rare Disease Day in Massachusetts.
That was wonderful. Thank you, Representative Benson. So now we get to the inspiring part of our morning, where we get to listen to the voices of people who are living every day in the world of rare disease. Mark Barillas has practiced healthcare law for 35 years and is with the firm of Verrill Dana here in Boston. He has severe hemophilia and also contracted HIV and hepatitis C from transfusions in the 1980s. He's worked with bleeding disorders organizations throughout his adulthood. He's married and the father of two great kids. And despite the difficulties of chronic disease, he counts himself a very fortunate person. Mark is an amazing example of what is possible when rare disease research creates treatments that can impact patients' lives. Mark?
Thank you so much, Katie. Wow, the view is pretty striking from up here. I've never attended the Rare Disease Day. This is quite a spectacle and a real testament to sort of the power of constituencies that are represented here. So of course it's a great, great privilege to stand here with you. And I have to admit that while I have a story, it's only one story. And there are many stories, of course, as with any disease group, that could go with hemophilia as well. Hemophilia is a complicated, difficult condition to manage and treat. There are a few types of hemophilia. There are two principal types, and there are extremely rare types, but they all relate to deficiencies, really glitches in the genetic recipe, such that people lack the ability to actually produce critical clotting proteins, and there are a number of them. The result, as you may already be very familiar, is a limitation on ability to clot with bleeds, and that's true of internal and external bleeds. Either can be very serious, either can be life-threatening. A lot of bleeding is internal. Perhaps the most common situation is bleeding into muscles, superficial bleeding in the form of bruises, bleeding into joints. This is very much a problem because when you bleed into a joint, it gets inflamed and painful and it damages the joint, obviously. But worse still, over time with repeated bleeds, the joint breaks down, the cartilage breaks down, deformities appear, and it can lead to long-term arthritis, arthropathy, damage, in extreme cases, ambulation restrictions. So as you can imagine, just from that description of these perils, it struck me that there are so many people who could really be telling the story of hemophilia, including parents of young children with hemophilia. You can imagine the terror that goes with that. And I'm sure we have people in exactly that circumstance in the audience. We might have had a young man who's developed antibodies, cruelly antibodies, to the medications that can actually promote clotting of bleeds. For those individuals, they are very much without resources. They're in another sort of primitive stage of management of the disease. So I did stop and think as late as this morning, what sense is there to my being for today, face of hemophilia? In part, it's a very old face. I'm 64. But then I thought, you know, this day is about hope, ultimately, because the research enterprise itself is fundamentally based on hope. And I thought that something else that's so well illustrated here today is community. And that, too, is a source of hope. And then I thought about, well, you know, in my 64 years, I've seen how it was when there wasn't a great wellspring of hopeful research going on, and I've seen today, which is very different. And from a community standpoint, it happens that I grew up in a military family. I was a military brat. And so we hopped all around, and it never, it was never apparent to me or to my parents that maybe there was a wider community of people similarly affected. So, at least in my early years, I knew nothing about the fact that there were like-minded, like-situated people contending with the same challenges as we were. In fact, I didn't even meet another person with hemophilia until I was 13. And that's the only person I met until coming to Massachusetts for school and suddenly finding that there are organizations, there are advocacy organizations, tremendous organizations. The New England Hemophilia Association, and I see many faces from NEHA here, is very much the regional entity that works so hard to pull together the community throughout New England. And I do want to say something about the value of that. I suspect this is generalizable to all groups because of the terrible, maybe the worst, oppression of rare diseases, that terrible feeling of aloneness and sort of owning that one on your own, of having been singled out by fate to deal with a host of challenges and problems that seem singular to you. It's a very lonely place to be, as I'm sure many people in this hall know from firsthand experience. So community is very important for dispelling the anxiety and the fear of that. But it's more than that, of course. Community gives you the ability to multiply yourself and to be more than one person. One person can achieve great things. It's an extraordinary circumstance. The odds are somewhat better in your favor as part of a community of committed people who are banded together to achieve the same things for each other. And as a small example of that, I do want to steal some legislative thunder here. There are two national hemophilia organizations. They were successful in getting the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services to declare March as Bleeding Disorders Awareness Month. That was last year. And now, NEHA is doing its darndest to replicate that fact in the Massachusetts state governments. I'm sorry, the New England state governments. In Massachusetts, they've been very successful thanks to the support of Representative Joe McKenna from Worcester, who will later be presenting to the hemophilia community here and the bleeding disorders community a joint resolution that he, along with 44 other co-sponsors in the House, and that includes Representative Benson, thank you, and four co-sponsors in the Senate, managed to see to adoption. It's that sort of thing that's just tremendous. And similar activity is afoot in Rhode Island and New Hampshire and Vermont with great success to secure the same sort of recognition and raised consciousness. So that's, you know, you can only do that when you're united in a truly special solidarity with people who struggle as you do. Let me talk about research as well, because as I say, 64 pretty much covers the modern history of hemophilia treatment, and that's gone a long way. When I was born, someone with hemophilia had a life expectancy of only 18 to 25 years. There was no way to treat bleeds unless you just packed a bleeding joint, say, in ice, and maybe stuck your foot in a bucket of ice water, as I did many times, and then you just suffered for weeks on your back waiting for that blood to be reabsorbed, and you were just in delirious pain at night. And so who would want their child to go through that? Today, the picture is very, very different. There are wonderful management techniques. Now, clotting proteins have been greatly concentrated. We've seen generations and generations of improved products, and they hold out the ability now for families to treat bleeds at home, for young children to self-infuse. There have been tremendous advances, and more are coming. It is simply unbelievable to me when I hear of the innovative, brilliant microbiological strategies to bring on board therapies that could eradicate antibodies to these medications, and even therapies that hint at a cure. So I face a sort of curious prospect of maybe, before I'm done, being cured of hemophilia, which would be very strange indeed. But if that becomes a possibility, I fully intend to, with my peers, to cut the line, because we've waited the longest. So there is great reason for hope. Thank you.
What a great reason to jump a line, Mark. That's right. You've been waiting. You know, and it's hard for me to hear Mark talk about those concepts of isolation and loneliness, but we know that they exist. How many people in this room love someone who is rare? So how alone can we be, right? Thank you, Mark, for that moving speech about what can happen when we are full circle and research can make a difference. And that leads us to a woman who is at the beginning of a rare disease journey. Janice Creedon is an advocate, fundraiser, and a rare parent in our rare disease community. Janice's 5-year-old son, Luke, has an undiagnosed genetic disorder that has impacted their family's life in every way imaginable. Luke's symptoms, illnesses, hospitalizations, and surgeries create as many questions as they do answers. But there are things that Janice and her family know for sure. They know that they're committed to understanding their son's condition and connecting him with the best care possible. They are determined that when there is no roadmap laid out or path to follow, that they will pave a new road. Janice is an example of the action you can take when you don't even know where you're going. Janice?
Good morning. Just as Katie said, I am a rare mom. I knew I was considered rare, the typical definition of rare, even before little man's birth. I'm the mother of four, and their ages are, brace yourself, 5, 7, 22, and 26. Ironically, each one of my babies were born in a different decade of my life, and in a different season. At that point, that was all I knew about being a rare mom. My pregnancy with Luke was super uneventful, easiest of the four. My pregnancy, much like his birth, was uneventful. I remember when he was brought to me, I saw him for the first time, and I fell in love instantly. I also remember getting this feeling when I saw him, some sort of tingle that said, this one's different. I asked every nurse, close friend, when they looked at him, like, does he look okay? I was constantly being reassured. He was beautiful. He was perfect. In every sense of the word, they were correct. He was beautiful. He was perfect, just in his own way. This is Luke. He's 5 years old. He has the most beautiful blue eyes. And trust me, he knows how to play them. He has the best sense of humor. He has a huge imagination. He loves Buzz Lightyear, race cars, superheroes. In many ways, he is a superhero. As I'm mustering up every gram of courage to get up here and share the story of our little man, he's presently on his 28th day of being hospitalized. This is his 12th admission in 1 year. I can and will do anything to be his voice. Luke has a very rare genetic mutation. It's so rare it doesn't even have a name. Just a bunch of letters and a number, LTB1. He is the first reported case. Call it mother's intuition, instinct, whatever. The moment that followed his birth, something just felt wrong. His behavior is, he was different. The way he ate was atypical. I kept asking his former pediatrician, is he okay? Constantly reassured. He's good. You're doing a great job. As much as I wanted to believe him and I appreciated the praise, something just didn't feel right. Fortunately, at 6 months old, Luke's present pediatrician, the amazing David Dr. Chung, he was covering. He looked up at Luke and said, is he always like this? I replied, yes. He stepped out of the room and got an appointment for him at the neurology department at Boston Children's Hospital. Mother's instinct was correct. He was more than just a super easy, laid-back baby. Something indeed was wrong. And that is the first page of our unknown. I've never been to Boston Children's Hospital before. I've only heard stories. Put money in the collection for Dunkin' Donuts and Walmart. But walking in there, seeing those kids, seeing the looks of the parents' faces, I was instantly humbled and intimidated. During a neurology appointment, they did a full examination. I vividly recall the doctor looking at Luke's right hand and noticed a straight line going across. I felt like I was going to pass out. As I remembered, in nursing school, the kids with Down syndrome usually have one on their right hand. How did I ever notice it? How did I miss that? And as I was thinking that, the neurologist flipped his left hand over. Same thing. Looked at his feet. Same thing. I remember thinking, my son does not have Down syndrome, which of course, being at 41 years old, was my biggest fear. I can't help but reflect and laugh. And Down syndrome is a diagnosis. It's a syndrome. People know what to expect with Down syndrome. There's a lot of information for families with children with support for kids with Down syndrome. We have nothing. Obviously, neurology noticed his low tone, small size. They titled him Failure to Thrive. That one still hurts. Luke's pediatrician same amazing David Dr. Chung, gave us the best advice. When he found out that neurology referred us to a bunch of different departments, one being genetics. He warned us that there'd be a lot of questions, full examinations, possibly pictures, but when we left there, we'd feel like we were ran over by a truck. He was right, again, as usual. His genetic ordered some genetic testing. Those test results are the reason I am here today. It took about 8 weeks for those tests to come back. And we were told he had a huge deletion on the second chromosome. I've been a nurse for about 15 years at the time, and the only thing I remembered about chromosomes was we had 22. Basically, I knew nothing. She explained to us in the most basic term what a chromosome looks like, the areas on it, the long arm, the short arm. Luke has a deletion in the second chromosome. 5.6 megabytes of data is missing. That's huge. And the short arm of this chromosome is the area of 22.3 to 22.2. She went on to say that the reason why this is so concerning is no other case has ever been reported. My husband and I looked at each other and looked at her and said, "So what does that mean?" Her answer, "I don't know." I don't know. That sentence has been said about a million times since that afternoon. Luke, whatever the heck syndrome he has, affects every muscle in his body. He's super low-toned, his muscles are floppy. Between October 2015 to present, he's had over 150 outpatient appointments and numerous overnight stays at Boston Children's Hospital. He's admitted for various illnesses, surgeries, procedures, as Katie was saying. Last year, that picture over there holding the dinosaur, that one over there rather, that picture was taken in June. He was waiting to go in the OR to have a very large hole fixed in his heart. He's doing great, by the way. It's affected chronic respiratory issues, entire life. Unfortunately, his illness seems to be getting worse. It's hard to recover from. They're coming more frequently. He now has permanent damage to some areas in his lungs. I was recently told his lungs look like a kid with cystic fibrosis. Although during his admission in November, they tested him for it. It came back negative. But part of me was hoping that he would come back positive for this horrible condition. At least you have a diagnosis. There's significant research and information about that disease. When you're living rare or undiagnosed, everything is affected. You're seen as unreliable. Life can change within a matter of days. It can change within even a matter of hours. Because so many times you have to call and say you can't be present. Whether it be for holidays, parties, work. It so greatly affects employment. Clearly, time and attendance can be a problem. I'm personally in the midst of an ugly FMLA battle. Relationships even change. Your lifelong friends become close acquaintances. Therapists become family. It's even hard for me to have a conversation with another medically typical child. I hate the term normal. I just can't relate to moms like that anymore. It affects the entire family unit. My 7-year-old daughter, Cecilia, hasn't seen her mommy home in more than 3 nights in 28 days. And I don't know when I'm coming home either. Last year, she went through a phase where she was afraid of germs and sicknesses, became obsessive about washing her hands and avoiding kids that she perceived as possibly being sick. In her little mind, if they shared their germs to her and she gave them to Luke, he could get sick. And Luke gets sick, he goes to the hospital. And when Luke goes to the hospital, mommy goes away. There's a lot of guilt having a complex child. I'm constantly apologizing, well aware of my shortcomings. There's also the ultimate guilt felt from the president who passed along the genetic rare mutation. It's irrational, but it's there. Rare diseases are presented, we're represented by zebras. That's the rare disease, that is the animal of choice. But sometimes I feel like I'm a mother to a zebra who happens to resemble a unicorn, you know? Let me tell you, this all may sound like negatives, but it's not. He's a joy. He's a prankster. He's my punkarooski. He's a flirt. Just ask any one of those nurses, he'll tell you. Those eyes. Ugh. I've learned so much from being a rare mom. I've learned more medically in the past 5 years than I have as 20 years of being a nurse. I've learned to lie. I've learned when someone asks how I'm doing, I usually smile and shrug and say, hey, living the dream. That's my go-to, just living the dream, it's good. I've learned to appreciate something good in every single day. Every single day I say, tell me something good. Because ultimately, I'm blessed. I'm blessed. Someone is always having a harder, longer battle than I am. And I'm completely surrounded by warriors. I'm a better friend. I'm a better human being because of it. I love my children, including giving this presentation at a state house, scared to death of public speaking. I know that the unknown scares me. Research needs to be supported. Just want to say that. People speak of the five-year plan, typically about the future, and this is a subject I tend to avoid. Luke is five. He is handsome. He's happy. He plays hard. He walks. He talks. All things we weren't sure he'd ever be able to do. But I don't know what another 5 years looks like. He's not getting better. In fact, he's getting sick more often. Last year in Rare Disease Day, I stood right over there. We were passing out the tags. I was volunteering doing that. And I gathered every bit of courage I had, and I accepted that microphone, and I asked the question. What about the undiagnosed community? What about them? There are so many unknowns. Obviously, my hope is that more research will be done. Somewhere, anywhere, another case is reported. What I'd give to have a conversation with another mother in any language, what she sees in her child. What are the similarities? What are the differences? Is her child a boy? I said research needs to be supported because, simply put, research saves lives. What I know for certain is living rare isn't easy. It can be seen as scary. It can be scary. It can be lonely at times. But if I was given a choice of sons, I still would have chosen him. Because just like the nurses said the day he was born, he is beautiful and he is perfect. Thank you.
Thank you, Janice. I just said to her, you're not a woman who's afraid of public speaking. Janice and I had coffee together a few weeks ago, and I said to her, think about everything you do that's so hard every day. You can do this. Walk in the park, right? Thank you for that inspiring look into what happens when we don't know where to go. Our next speaker, Justin Peavy, is an example of someone who is willing to take action at an early age. Justin Peavy is a first-year student at Suffolk University. He also is a co-founder and co-operator of the nonprofit Center Stage Theater Company in northeastern Massachusetts. Aside from his schooling, his business, and his numerous other hobbies, Justin is also an advocate for awareness of frontal temporal degeneration. Driven by his family's strong genetic history, Justin shares his story wherever he goes and works with local organizations to help him spread important information about it. Justin, we're lucky to have you today.
Good morning. I would introduce myself, but Katie just did a wonderful job of doing so already. I'm honored to be standing before all of you today to share my personal experiences with a rare disease. And I'm going to start off by painting a picture for you, and believe me, I wish it were a nicer picture. You are 5 years old. Your grandmother starts acting different. She starts yelling at you more often over things that you probably shouldn't be yelled at for. She starts to put boxes of popsicles in the fridge rather than the freezer, and then they melt. She struggles to find words for everyday household objects. And you don't really think much of it. She's just getting old, you think, when in reality she's only in her early 60s. And eventually things get more threatening to her health. Things that were essential parts of her daily routine, such as taking her insulin, would slip her mind more and more often. You're 6 years old now. You are with her the day she goes into the nursing home, which is her residence for the next year and a half. She slowly becomes more quiet. She starts forgetting who you are to her. When you say hello, instead of returning a friendly greeting, she laughs. Or she has fear in her eyes. It really depends on the day. You are 8 years old. Grandma is confined to a wheelchair. She has lost all ability to speak, and she no longer looks like the same woman anymore. Books about Alzheimer's disease that have been checked out of the library suddenly pop up all around your house. Your mom visits the nursing home every single day, and now you start to stay behind because it's too sad to watch. After months of this, your mother gets a call from the nursing home at midnight, and she immediately gets into her car and drives 20 minutes to say her goodbyes. You go to the funeral mourning an incredible woman who was robbed of her personality, her physicality, and most importantly to her, her love for her own family. Now imagine going through that experience three times over the course of 8 years. 3 years after my grandmother passed away, her sister did too, after dealing with similar symptoms for years. My grandma and my aunt Betty were both diagnosed with frontotemporal degeneration after their deaths. When a neuropathology lab analyzed samples of their brain. Of course, I was only 11 years old when Auntie Betty died, and I didn't understand what frontotemporal degeneration meant. It was just a bunch of words to me. It's kind of like Alzheimer's, but different, was the best description I could have gotten back then. Now, allow me to explain for anyone who is hearing about FTD for the first time today. FTD refers to a group of early onset, ultimately terminal, neurological disorders that attack the frontal and the temporal lobes of the brain. These lobes are in charge of controlling the following: speech, judgment, mobility, memory, and behavior. As these lobes' ability to function deteriorates, the patient loses all of who they are and what makes them unique. The patient's communication skills, ability to move on their own, and personality fades away until there is little to none left. The disease is rare in itself, but genetic or familial cases are even less common. But back to the narrative. A couple of years pass after Auntie Betty dies, and FTD is traveling further and further away from my memory. And then in November 2011, when I was only 13 years old, I find that I would have to get used to thinking about FTD, because ever since then, not a day would pass where FTD would not be on my mind. My mom's brother, Danny, was clinically diagnosed with FTD that fall. Because of the strong family history, my mom's family got involved with the FTD unit at Mass General to learn more about the genetic possibilities of the disease. A mutated chromosome has been linked to the development of the disease, even though it is not the only cause. And upon genetic testing, it was revealed that my uncle had inherited this from my grandmother. The good news was now that we had a tracker. The bad news was that the tracker has been found in the genes of two more of his siblings, one of them being my mother. A fear that I had as a child was suddenly many years closer to becoming a reality. My mother has a 95% chance of developing the disease in her future, and because my mother has inherited this chromosome, my brothers and I each have a 50% chance of having inherited it from her. My immediate response to all of this naturally was sadness and fear. My middle school years were clouded by FTD, which became a darker and more prominent malevolent force in my life. But my secondary response was to do something about it rather than sit idly by. And there are three reasons for that. First, I have seen FTD take the lives of three family members of mine, but I know that I have many extended family members that have dealt with it as well, and I know that I will see it strike again multiple times in my future. It's in my medical records, family history of FTD, 50% chance of inheritance. It is a possible fate that I have to be prepared for. Second, my grandmother was misdiagnosed twice. Her clinical diagnosis was Alzheimer's disease, naturally. And the neuropathological diagnosis that came 6 months after her death was Lewy body dementia. It was not until 10 years after her death that we got the definitive evidence that she had FTD the entire time. This is a disease that is commonly misdiagnosed because there is an extreme lack of awareness. And third, there are no clinical treatments or cures for this disease. FTD is a terminal and irreversible illness. It is a devastating thing to watch, let alone experience three times before you even turn 16. FTD steals patients from their loved ones, but it also steals patients from themselves. These three factors are what motivated me to contact the Association for Frontotemporal Degeneration, the AFTD, as well as the Mass General FTD unit and take action. What started as a small fundraiser in a middle school cafeteria is now an internet campaign entitled FTD Exists, and it is dedicated to honoring my family, spreading awareness of the disease, and raising funds that would be donated to research and drug discovery programs. Since my campaign started in February 2012, I have raised over $5,000 that have been donated to the AFTD. In more recent years, I've combined my passion for raising awareness with my passion for theater, a subject I'm currently studying in college. And I have directed a full-length musical that premiered on the 9th anniversary of my grandmother's passing, and a portion of the proceeds were donated to the AFTD. I also combined my interest in genealogy with my research efforts by working on a pedigree chart to further track family history and family inheritance of the disease. The theme of today is patient involvement in research. Patients play crucial roles in the development of research, but so do their caretakers. And that is the same way with their families. Taking action is not a hard thing. You do not need a certain amount of experience. Sometimes when it's a rare disease, all it takes is a combination of word of mouth and hope, which leads to a sense of greater recognition and understanding, and ultimately helps us move towards our goal of finding a cure. Thank you.
Thank you, Justin, for being so brave and open and telling us that you didn't have to wait to start doing something to make a difference in your life and in the lives of other families with FTD. Our next speaker is Patrick Lacey. Patrick is the founder and president of the board of BeatNB, a Massachusetts-based nonprofit driving neuroblastoma cancer research and raising awareness for neuroblastoma, with the hope of finding viable treatments and ultimately a cure for neuroblastoma. Patrick's son, Will, was diagnosed with this rare form of childhood cancer as an infant, inspiring Patrick's tireless passion to his mission. Will's story and BeatNB's tenacity in the face of hopelessness were recently chronicled in a 5-part series in the Boston Globe this past December. Patrick is an example of the ripple effect of the actions of a big movement, starting from the ground up. Patrick?
Morning, everyone. So as mentioned, I founded BeatNB, NB standing for neuroblastoma. It's a solid cancer of childhood. It forms anywhere along the spine, many times atop the adrenal glands. It is the most common cancer seen in infants. It is a cancer diagnosed usually at the age of 2. And although it only accounts for 7% of pediatric cancer diagnoses in this country each year, it accounts for 15% of childhood cancer deaths. So stage 4 neuroblastoma, that's one of the diseases where we're losing our kids. And my son Will, he's our firstborn child, he was diagnosed with stage 4 neuroblastoma at the age of 6 months. And so what do you do when your child gets cancer, right? You go to Children's Hospital, you go to Dana-Farber, and these experts treat your child with the care they deserve, the care they need, and the care that's required to get them into remission. Sadly, with this disease, it does not work. Sadly, for this disease, the outcome is very poor, and that's what happened with my child. After 18 months of chemotherapy, after 18 months of every known curative therapy, we walked into a room. That room was filled with strangers wearing long white coats, longer faces, and we were told that our son had exhausted all known curative therapies, and that at that point in time, the best outcome for us would be to probably focus on his quality of life. Quality of life means, how do you want your child to die? Do you want to chase down a rabbit hole some cure with these phase 1 studies of a dose escalation of a drug far below efficacy levels seen in adult studies? Do you travel overseas? Do you try unproven therapies in the hope that you can do something? Or do you focus on spending time with your child, creating memories, becoming intimately familiar with the pain management team at the hospital, and focus your energy that way? Those are two terrible choices, and no one would want either one of them for their child. And so what we decided to do, and which is ironic given patient-driven is what we're talking about today, is put the patient first. What is in the best interest of our child, not my own selfish needs? I don't want to put what I want in the way of what's best for him. And so we took our lead from him. We took our lead for what he wanted to do and how he was able to enjoy life, and we would let that guide the way. And the way that led us to was research. When there's nothing out there for your child to do to save their life, well, you can't hope or pray your way out of that. You need to create options, and that's what we did. I could sit here for 14 hours describing all the things that are broken, all the things that don't work, all the obstacles in the way, or I can sit here for the next 5 minutes and tell you how we created solutions for these kids that so desperately need our help. And so by looking at research, by traveling in the country, by meeting every neuroblastoma expert, by working with like-minded families, we discovered that hope was not indefensible. We discovered that hope is a real thing, and it lives, and it breathes, and it needs funding, and it needs patients leading the way. No one wants these children to die. No researcher, no pharmaceutical company. Everyone wants these kids to live, but the question becomes, who's ultimately responsible for that? Right? Is everyone to blame? Is everyone at fault? No. But by working together, by collaborating, by bringing researchers across different disciplines, across different hospitals, and always driving with the patient first, always saying, what are we going to do for the kids today? That's how you can affect change. And so, while treading water, we had to build a life raft. So with these research dollars, with this collaboration, we were able to enroll my son on a phase one study that we raised the money for. And while he was on that study, we continued to raise money. And just after about 1 year, we put him on another phase one study that we helped to fund, and then another. And slowly, momentum began to build. My child was still alive. He was dictating what we did, his quality of life, his enjoyment, his everything he wanted to do in life. If he could continue to do it, and we weren't sacrificing that, we would continue to push forward. And that journey built, and we met other families and other researchers. And slowly, this one hospital and this one researcher turned into a consortium. And that consortium turned into 30 hospitals across this country offering this therapy. That consortium has sites overseas. That consortium, we've now funded 19 clinical trials across this country for kids with neuroblastoma. Thank you. And what we discovered in this journey, the answers are there. The researchers are there. The clinicians are there. It's collaboration and research and getting everyone to focus on what is best for the patient today that's going to improve outcomes. It's what kept my son alive. It's why my now 12-year-old son is sitting in a seventh grade classroom right now listening to his social studies teacher. It's why there's children from all over the globe are coming to this country, this incredible nation that we live in, that we're fortunate to be a part of, to get these cures, to get these treatments for their families. It's why we're opening these studies in Canada. It's why we're opening these studies overseas, because all these people came together to work to make sure that the patients today who desperately needed our help were getting it. And we're doing that in the form of genetic research. We have a clinical trial that's open September of 2015 that's doing RNA and DNA sequencing and upfront clinical trials with newly diagnosed patients to add a tailored drug to their therapy. We have a clinical trial that saved my son's life. It's an oral pill, a repurposed drug that was abandoned as an FDA-approved option for cancer 20 years ago that's now in clinical trials and 400 kids have taken it. It's an oral pill with no side effects. And what this drug does is it keeps kids in remission, okay? Neuroblastoma responds well to high-dose chemotherapy, but kids don't stay there. But 60% of those kids relapse. There's no cure for relapse. We have a clinical trial that now is about 90% of those kids staying in remission thanks to this oral pill, because doctors in breast cancer, doctors in research, doctors in Hawaii all said, let's put these kids first. And the role of an advocate and the role of families is to stand in that room. And you can remind these folks at times because it is a Byzantine structure. Academic medicine is a confusing place to me as an outsider. I get headaches sometimes trying to understand the rules and all these obligations that people have to things that don't make sense to me. But if you sit in that room and you remind people why we're there, if you sit in that room and say, well, what about this kid? What about the kid right now who's on that trajectory to death that we can intersect by simply making these options available now? And that kind of focus on the patient is what's driving change in the consortium that we fund. And we are now aimed to put this disease where, you know, leukemia was survival-wise till today. We're going to do that same thing with this disease simply because people all across this country in different research disciplines decided enough's enough. And that's the power of being patient-driven. So I'd like to thank everyone for coming here today to talk about rare disease. It's a hard thing to talk about. As Janice said, it's a difficult thing because you do feel alone. You do feel left out. You do feel that you're not part of something else you can talk about. And if any clinicians or researchers in the room, I'd also point to something Janice said, and that's no matter what else happens, no matter what else you see, never doubt a mother's intuition. When my, As much as you might want to as a man, you know, I apologize if that's... But my own wife at birth said to me that there's something wrong. And it took 6 months to get the diagnosis. And he had a tumor growing in his chest the whole time. I saw what I wanted to see. She saw the real answer. So that's just a very powerful message that Janice delivered that I'd like to share. So again, I'm very happy to be here today. Patient-driven is how things are going to be achieved. And I'm really excited to see all the changes that can happen across all these rare diseases if everyone makes that choice to work together and to keep the patient first. Thank you.
Patrick, come on. That was awesome. Thank you for that. I'm so proud of our inspiring panel this morning. And now I want to turn the microphone over to Tim Boyd from NORD so that we can talk about what is the action, what are the things that are happening in our rare disease community today. Tim?
Thank you. I'm actually just up here to introduce another speaker real quickly, but NORD is part of a coalition supporting a step therapy fail first bill here in Massachusetts. We are joined by the leadership of the National Patient Advocate Foundation, the Epilepsy Foundation of New England, the Massachusetts Pain Initiative, National Psoriasis Foundation, the Crohn's and Colitis Foundation of America, and the U.S. Pain Foundation. And if you are someone who is affected by step therapy or has difficulty getting the right medication at the right time, after today's program, I encourage you to find Mary and Allison in the back. We would love to help you share your story with legislators. But I have a better person here to talk about this bill, and I'm happy to introduce Dr. Elaine Kuriakopoulos. She is the Chief Operating Officer at the Epilepsy Foundation of New England. She is a neurologist, an epileptologist, and a graduate of the McMaster Medical School and the University of Western Ontario in Canada. Dr. Kuriakopoulos completed her neurology residency and epilepsy fellowship training at the Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center in Boston. Her clinical and academic career were based in the Department of Neurology at Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center and Harvard University. She joined the Epilepsy Foundation of New England in 2016 and also serves on the editorial board of the Epilepsy Foundation of America. And she is a passionate advocate on behalf of people with epilepsy. And she's here to talk about step therapy fail first bill.
Thank you for your kind introduction. And I just want to say thank you to the efforts taken to organize the presentations shared here today. So heartfelt, so powerful, so moving, and so inspiring. Thank you all. I'd also like to thank you for the opportunity to address everyone who's gathered. On behalf of the Epilepsy Foundation New England, our president and CEO, Susan Lin, and the tens of thousands of patients and families affected by a diagnosis of epilepsy in Massachusetts, I would like to extend a special thank you to Representative Jennifer Benson and the 18 co-sponsors who joined her in filing House Bill 492, and to Senator Barbara Letellier and her co-sponsors for filing the Senate Companion Bill, Senate 551. These bills can improve treatments for persons with epilepsy and others living with chronic and rare diseases. I would also like to take a moment to thank Representative Michael Day for taking the time to meet with myself and our Director of Advocacy, Bill Murphy, earlier this morning. I would like to encourage everyone gathered here to take the time to write and meet with their legislatures to work towards change. I'd like to share with you a little bit about the diagnosis of epilepsy. Epilepsy is a medical condition that affects the brain. It produces seizures, affecting a variety of mental and physical functions. Approximately 1 in 26 Americans will develop epilepsy at some point in their lifetime. And at this time, it is estimated that there are nearly 3 million Americans facing the challenges of epilepsy. I'm here today, along with my colleagues and members of our epilepsy community, advocating for epilepsy patients and families whose lives are affected daily by the healthcare paradigm known as step therapy or fail-first medicine. This severely limits their access to care and impacts the quality of their life. The Epilepsy Foundation New England and the Epilepsy Foundation of America oppose step therapy and similar policies intended to restrict access to physician-directed care that unnecessarily prolongs ineffective treatment and prevents individuals from immediately starting the treatments their doctors think is best. Step therapy, or fail first, is a process used by insurance companies to require individuals who have been prescribed certain medications by their doctors to try and fail one or more medications preferred by the insurer before receiving the desired medicine actually prescribed by the individual's physician. In other words, step therapy precludes best practice. It absolutely forces providers and their patients to choose and prescribe a medication based on coverage and cost, and not what is best for the individual's health. It often requires patients fail multiple medications before they are allowed coverage for what is the most appropriate drug. Step therapy also creates a process whereby a patient may be allowed access to all medications, but poses immense financial burdens with higher co-pays or deductibles for medications commonly used to control seizures. In effect, this limits a person's ability to afford the medication they need. There's no one-size-fits-all treatment option for epilepsy. The response to epilepsy medications is different for each person. Maintaining seizure control with minimal side effects requires careful evaluation and monitoring by the physician and patient. To change, limit, or deny access to medications could be extremely dangerous. People living with epilepsy who have their medications switched or who experience a delay in accessing their medication due to onerous step therapy requirements are at high risk for developing breakthrough seizures and related complications. Failing to treat a person's epilepsy with the best possible medication can also lead to depression, which further increases both morbidity and risk for death. It has been demonstrated that people with uncontrolled epilepsy are at a greater risk for depression and have higher rates of suicide. Furthermore, step therapy significantly increases medical costs related to preventable seizures, along with lost wages and productivity, not just for the individuals living with epilepsy, but also for their families and their communities. During my time in clinic caring for patients and in my role at Epilepsy Foundation New England, I've had the opportunity to both experience as a caregiver and witness firsthand the detrimental effects of step therapy policies. Epilepsy patients rely on their physicians to guide them to make the best choices. For a person living with epilepsy, their constant and immediate goal is to have their seizures well controlled on medication with the least amount of side effect possible. I would like to share with you these words from colleagues, one of Boston's most well-respected clinicians, Dr. Barbara Duretsky, the chief of epilepsy at Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston, an associate professor at Harvard Medical School, shares her perspective. She states, "I'm a neurologist who mainly takes care of patients with epilepsy. I do my best to help them out through the many struggles of medications not working, insurance carriers sending them letters in the mail, telling them all of a sudden that their medications are no longer covered, and a variety of other hurdles. This is such a common occurrence and a common disease. Yet, I strongly feel if the people making these rules had a beloved family member with epilepsy, they would not create such dangerous policies. She says, I try to choose simple and cheaper regimens when I start therapy. However, by the time I choose a drug for a patient, I am considering many factors. The medications that didn't work, the adverse effects that are likely, the interactions with other medications, and the desired medication effects. It has become more and more difficult to treat patients with all of the hurdles and delays that are in place to save money, but not to help patients. Suggestions are fine, but mandates to fail first are very dangerous. I have many stories about how patients went without medications because they were told they could no longer have them, and this led to a seizure. To be clear, the fail-first policies which currently exist affect both adult and pediatric patients, children. I would also like to share with you the following assessment and request regarding step therapy and the need for changes in the paradigm which exists. This statement was provided by Dr. Philip Pearl, the Director of Epilepsy and Clinical Neurophysiology at Children's Hospital Boston and the William G. Lennox Chair and Professor of Neurology at Harvard Medical School. He shares, the cost-guided step approach has provided a real obstacle to attaining seizure control in some of our most vulnerable children with severe epilepsy. Please help us with safeguards and an appeal process in selected cases, as non-preferred medicines we are forced to cycle through only lead to more misery with ongoing seizures and unwanted side effects. I would also like to take this opportunity to share the words of people living with epilepsy. When asked, what would the effect of a single breakthrough seizure mean to you? Here is what they had to say. It means waking up feeling lost. It means waking up immediately after the seizure and feeling like someone is slamming a hammer against the sides of my head. It means muscle aches and pain for days. It makes it hard to have friends. It makes it hard to learn and means I have to miss school a lot. It means pain and it means sadness. It means financially taking at least one day off from work and then having to find alternate transportation to and from work for up to 6 months. It means big medical costs, which could include emergency room visits, blood work, testing. It is no exaggeration to say it means hundreds of dollars. It means that I am vulnerable, knowing that even one seizure may lead to the fact that I may not be able to provide for my wife and kids. It means feeling embarrassed if it happens at work. No one wants to convulse in front of colleagues. No one wants to lose control of their bodily functions in a boardroom. It means seizures upend my life and my family's life. It is the worst feeling as an adult to lose your independence, to need your family and friends in a way that makes you feel like you have failed. It means fear. What if I don't wake up next time? It terrifies me. What if it happens when I'm driving my kids to school? If I think about it too much, it paralyzes me. It means I never want to leave my house. I feel that it is imperative that I convey to you today that patients with inadequate seizure control have a greater risk of emergencies related to uncontrolled seizures, and this can result in death. Sudden unexpected death in epilepsy happens in 1 out of 150 people with uncontrolled epilepsy. This fact alone should be enough for people to recognize that fail first step therapy policies must change. Every breakthrough seizure presents a risk. Over and above this alarming number, consider the fact that for a person with epilepsy, having seizures as a result of medication restriction has dangerous consequences which extend beyond the patient. A person with epilepsy could have a seizure while driving, putting themselves and others at risk of injury and death. Economically, if a person has breakthrough seizures, limiting their ability to drive or work, this leads to financial risk and inevitably an increased dependence on government assistance and potentially the loss of health insurance coverage. Step therapy and fail-first medicine must end. Every patient has a right to the care they need. Physicians must be able to provide the care they feel most appropriate to their patients. For patients and families affected by epilepsy, fail-first policies inflict risk, harm, and potentially death. Thank you for your attention and your concern. The Epilepsy Foundation New England is here to provide help for today and hope for tomorrow for persons living with epilepsy. Our team will continue to advocate for our epilepsy community until our goal of no seizures, no side effects, and a cure for epilepsy become reality. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for attending today. As we close out this wonderful presentation, I want to let you know that if you have registered to speak with your legislator, you should go to Nord's table in the back. There are other events happening today. Genzyme just had a run with 250 people that took off from the Boston Common. And tonight at 7 on WGBH, you should be able to see a couple of members from this morning with Jim Browdy, 7 p.m. So as you leave today, I encourage you, don't just be inspired. Move to action. And let's make that first action, bringing everyone up to the front of the hall for our giant group photo with your paddles. Thank you. See you in 2018.